Situation. You're working on an e-commerce site and you need to generate a sales report. Now this report is going to query a lot of data across a lot of different date ranges, map over it, aggregate it all together in different ways, and then generate a nice visual report. So let's click the button and see what happens. Looks like this request is taking a long time to process. Let's see how long it takes. Hey, well, finally the request came back and we got a report and, you know, a lot of different metrics and everything is good. So we deploy this app to production. The problem is when we run the exact same code in production and try to generate the sales report, it takes a while again. But instead of returning the report like it did locally, instead it timed out with an application error. It turns out that long-running synchronous web requests in a production application are a really bad idea. And in order to get this code to work, we need to offload that long-running request into a background process that we can run asynchronously. But how do we do that? Well, you're about to learn today on an Always Be Coding screencast. Hit it! Before we write any code, let's analyze what's going on here. When we click on the Generate Report button, we're making an HTTP request to our web server, which in this case is deployed on Heroku. The web server will route the request to our application code, which in this case is a Rails app. So it goes through the middleware to the routes file, gets routed to the appropriate controller, which calls out to the model, which will fetch data from the database, return it to the controller. The controller will organize it in the proper format and send it back through the middleware, back through the web server, and finally back to our computer as an HTTP response. This entire process is what we would call a synchronous request response cycle. When we make a request, and from a UX perspective, we block our application from doing anything else until we get a result. But also from an infrastructure perspective, the process on Heroku that handles web requests is also blocked from handling any other web request until the current one is finished. On Heroku itself, one synchronous web request can last for a maximum of 30 seconds before it will time out and return an error. So if you have a long-running function, you are not going to be able to use it in a synchronous web request. Now, there's a very good reason why Heroku does this, by the way. On Heroku, what you're actually paying for is the number of application processes. These are also called dynos. Now, there are two different classes of dynos, web dynos and worker dynos. At a high level, a dyno is just a process that runs your Rails application code. But the web dynos are a special subset that are specifically made for handling web traffic. Heroku puts all the web dynos under what they call a routing mesh, which is similar to a load balancer, and it'll evenly distribute traffic across all your running web processes. This router will also queue up all incoming requests and choose which web dyno to send that traffic to. If your process that's handling that request is taking too long, you're going to queue up all the other requests behind it and nobody is ever going to get a response from the server. Your application would effectively be broken. So we need to introduce the concept of background processing. Instead of taking 30 seconds to answer the request immediately, we can add the request to a to-do list of sorts, then return immediately to the user with the message, "Hey, we added your request to a to-do list and we'll get back to you later." And the way this works in practice is with a queue. A queue is a data store similar to a database, but much simpler, because it's just a key value store without the need for data modeling the way you have in a SQL database. So instead of calling to the model to generate the report, we'll just put a message on a queue that we need a report generated, then return immediately to the user with a message that we're generating their report and we'll get back to them later. Then we're going to need to have a worker. A worker is just a Ruby object that is deployed on another process, which is separate from the process that is handling the web request. So in Heroku speak, this would be a worker dyno, and it will read the job off the queue and generate the report. Now this worker process is not restricted by the 30-second timeout, so it can take as long as it wants. Once it's done, we can perform some kind of action with the data. either emailing the report to the user or uploading it to an S3 bucket or adding it to a cache so the user can view it on the web without having to recalculate it. Anything we want, really. So let's actually go through the code of what this would look like. And we're going to need two things, Redis and Sidekiq. Redis is a database that we're going to use as the queue our application will write to. Sidekiq is a Ruby library for managing worker processes in Rails applications, and it will read off the queue to perform the jobs we put on it. So Redis is a database, it's a key value store. You can learn more about Redis at redis.io, but the good news is you don't really need to know that much about it to get started here. To install Redis, all you need to do is brew install Redis. And to run Redis, you just need to run the command Redis server. It'll start the server on port 6379, which is the default port Redis always starts on. If you want a command line interface into Redis, you can run the command Redis CLI. And this gives you basically a REPL into your Redis queue. You could get, for example, every object that's on the queue right now. This is some artifacts that have been created from running Sidekiq, which I'll show you in a sec. But that's pretty much it. You don't really need to know much else. So now we need to add the Sidekiq library. You can do that by going to your gem file and just adding the Sidekiq gem. One thing to note, though, is that Sidekiq comes pre-packaged with its own web UI. The web UI is written in Sinatra, so you need to add the Sinatra gem as well. And one other thing is that if you're using Rails 5, you might want to bundle the Sinatra app from source because there's some dependency issues with using older versions. Now we just need to bundle and start the web server. I'm going to start the web server on port 3003. Now, if we want to view the Sinatra web UI, we need to mount the Sidekiq app on our routes file. So we can go to routes and require sidekiq/web, and then mount the web module to any route we want. I'm going to mount it to /sidekiq. Now if I go to localhost 3003/sidekiq, I should see this dashboard that shows me how many jobs are on the Redis queue, how many are being processed, how many failed, how many are currently busy, the retries, the scheduled, and the dead. This is really useful. Now all we need to do is put a job on the queue and build a worker that can actually process the job and then monitor them from this UI. So let's start by building the Sidekiq worker. And we're gonna go to our app folder and create a new folder called workers. And I'm gonna make something called report_worker.rb. This is just a Ruby class. And I'm gonna include the module to make this a Sidekiq worker. You can also pass it some options under this parameter Sidekiq options. The one I like to always pass it is retry false. By default, a Sidekiq worker will retry over and over again if it fails. But I find for just like figuring out what's failed, what hasn't, it's easier if they don't automatically retry, if you have to manually retry them. And then every Sidekiq worker has a method called perform. This is what's run when it reads a message off the queue. And you can put messages on the queue with parameters and read them off with parameters. So for example, we could have a start date and end date for the report that it's trying to generate. And let's just put to the console, whenever this is run, Sidekiq worker running, Sidekiq worker generating a report from start date to end date and end. Now, in order to put a message on the queue, we'd need to do that from the controller. So this controller is what's generating the report right now. All that it does is sleep for 30 seconds to mimic a long request. But instead of doing that, let's enqueue a message to generate a report. So we can do that by calling to our report worker and calling the perform async function. That will tell Sidekiq to put this onto the queue. And let's pass it a mock start date of July 1st, 2016, and a mock end date of August 1st, 2016. And then we'll render text from this that just says, request to generate a report added to the queue. Now, if we go to /sales to generate sales report, click generate report, you'll see request to generate report added to the queue. And if we go to our Sidekiq queues and refresh this, we should see that we have one message enqueued.
that's the message that we just put on. If we go back to the UI to create a sales report and click it again, we'll see another message has been added to the queue, and now we can see that we have two messages in queued. So basically what we're doing now is when we make a request to the server, this controller right here will put the request to generate the report from these dates onto the queue and return immediately, as opposed to, you know, taking 30 seconds to actually generate the report. Now, this worker will read it off the queue and just write to console. So how do we run this? Well, all you need to do is go to your terminal and run Sidekiq. And by default, you can pass it this option-c of the number of threads you want to run. I'm just going to run one thread to make it easier. So I'm going to start up a worker by doing Sidekiq-c, and you'll see it started processing these. Sidekiq worker generating a report from 07/01/2016, and then this is it reading the second message, and now it waits idly for another message to be put on the queue. So nothing's being put on the queue, nothing's being written. If I go back to our UI to generate a report and I click generate, now we'll see that this just ran and it generated a report. You might be wondering how Sidekiq knew to be reading off that Redis queue, because we never really told it to do that. It turns out that's just the default behavior of Sidekiq, is that it's going to look for a Redis queue running on port 6379, and if it's there, then it knows that it's just going to read off there by default. So now I want to show you how to take that infrastructure we just built and deploy it to Heroku. The first thing you need to do is go to your proc file and define a new process type. This is going to be a worker process that you can scale up and down independently of your web process. I'm just going to call it report worker. We want to have this run the exact same code we're running locally, which is just to run the Sidekiq worker we defined. So I'm just going to call bundle exec sidekiq-c1. Now let's commit this code and deploy it. And push to Heroku. If we go to our Heroku app, we should see a new type of worker deployed, this report worker that we can choose to scale up independently of this web process. So we're going to need to add Redis to our Heroku deployment. Luckily, Heroku makes that about as easy as possible. We can just search for Redis in the add-ons and see they offer a variety of different Redis services. Redis to Go is probably the easiest one to use. They have a free tier. Just hit provision and Heroku will go ahead and set up a Redis queue on your server. Now, there's one thing you're going to need to do though, which is set an environment variable telling Sidekiq to look for the Redis provider and set that equal to the Redis to Go URL config variable. Now we should have Redis up and running. The only thing we're going to need to do now is start this report worker. You can either start it by clicking this button in the Heroku dashboard, or you can start it from the console. You can set Heroku PS scale report worker equals 1, which will basically tell Heroku to scale your dyno configuration so that you have one process of the report worker running. And we should be able to see that change reflected in the sandbox if we refresh it. You can see it right here. This was turned off before. Now, if we do Heroku logs-t, that'll give us our server logs of the server running on Heroku. You should now see two things. You should see this web.1, that's the web dyno. Anything in brackets is the name of the dyno, and report worker-1.1 is the name of the report worker. So anything that's being logged by this is being logged by the worker process. Anything that's being logged by this is being logged by the web process. So there's no jobs on the queue right now, so nothing's coming out. But if we go to abcsandbox.herokuapp.com/sales, we can generate a report in production. We'll get that same request to generate a port added to the queue, but we can see that the worker actually processed this. The web request came through, and then the report worker processed this request, generating a report from this. So our distributed system worked properly. So yeah, background processing is a really important part of web development. I hope that's a good high-level overview of how it works in the real world. You see that we could have easily taken that worker process and uploaded a report to an AWS S3 bucket and kind of completed the idea that I was going for there. In other words, I am on Twitter, at AlwaysBeCoding. You can hit me up in the comment section of this YouTube channel as well. Yo, this YouTube channel is about to blow the fuck up. I'm going to start making a lot more code-related content over the next couple months. It really helps to hear what I'm doing right, what I'm doing wrong. I love hearing from people. I'm going to make a screencast a day for the next 2 months. So I'm going to get on it. It's going to be really good stuff. Peace, guys.